Greetings. I'm the man behind the mask, and I would like to talk to you about hockey. Yes, let's talk about hockey, the show that journeys through the history of the sport of ice hockey from its disputed origins to the game we see today. When we left off, the WHA had finally collapsed and the NHL absorbed four teams from the former league, giving it 21 teams in all. But along with the new teams, the NHL also instituted a new rule in August of 1979 that made it mandatory for new players entering the league to wear protective helmets. Whereas players that had signed their pro contracts prior to June 1st, 1979, were given the option not to wear a helmet if they wanted to.
Along with the new teams came the return of two NHL legends for one more season in the league, Gordie Howe and Bobby Hull. Hull would play 18 games with the Winnipeg Jets before being dealt to Hartford, where he closed out the season alongside Gordie Howe, who played in all 80 of the Whalers' games and tallied 15 goals and 41 points at the age of 52, giving him an NHL record 801 career goals, 1,049 career assists, and 1,850 career points when he retired for a second time at the end of his 26th NHL season. Howe's final career marks in the NHL would not be the only record set this season, however. Behind winger Reggie Leach and goaltender Pete Peters, the Philadelphia Flyers would weave together a record 35-game undefeated streak, going 25-0-10, which propelled them to a league-best 48-12-20 record at the end of the regular season. Another record set was by Atlanta Flames center Gary Unger, whose Iron Man streak finally came to an end on December 21, 1980, after playing in 914 straight games. In addition to these records, there were also a few league firsts that took place. The 50 goals that Montreal center Pierre Larouche tallied this year would make him the first NHL player to produce a 50-goal season for two different NHL teams after he scored 53 for the Penguins back in the 1975-76 season. But the most interesting first for the league came on November 28, 1979. When after Islanders goaltender Billy Smith deflected the puck into the corner, Colorado rookie Rob Ramage picked up the puck and accidentally made a blind pass from the corner boards to the blue line. With nobody there to receive the pass, the puck sailed all the way down the length of the ice and into the Colorado net. Since Smith had been the last Islander to touch the puck, he became the first goaltender to be credited with a goal. However, with all of the positive events occurring throughout the year, this season did not go without at least one major incident. On December 23, 1979, during a post-game scrum between some players from the New York Rangers and the Boston Bruins, a Rangers fan stole the stick of Bruins winger Stan Jonathan and hit him with it. In retaliation, Boston's Terry O'Reilly scaled the glass boards and charged into the stands after the fan. His teammates followed when other fans tried to intervene, including defenseman Mike Milbury, who pried a shoe off one fan and started beating the guy with it. O'Reilly would ultimately be suspended 8 games for his part in the brawl, but the Rangers and Bruins rivalry had definitely reached a new level. Leaving all of that behind, the 1980-81 season began with the relocation of the Atlanta Flames club to Calgary, the only time ever that an American NHL team has relocated to Canada. Elsewhere in the league, the Quebec Nordiques became involved in international political intrigue when they helped the defection efforts of Czechoslovakian star Peter Stastny and his brother Anton. The two became immediate stars once they made their NHL debut in the 1980-81 season, with both combining for 16 total points in Quebec's 11-7 win over Washington on February 22, 1981, and Peter himself going on to set new league records for a rookie player by tallying 70 assists and 109 points en route to winning the Calder Trophy as Rookie of the Year. Stastny's scoring records wouldn't be the only long-standing records to be matched or broken this year, though. On January 24, 1981, the New York Islanders' Mike Bossy would become the first person since Maurice Richard to score 50 goals in 50 games. Additionally, over the course of the season, LA's Marcel Dion, Montreal's Guy Lafleur, and Philadelphia's Bobby Clark would all notch their 1,000th career point. And after Wayne Gretzky was teamed with Finnish sensation Jari Kurri, he would break Phil Esposito's point-scoring record by scoring 164 points. But scoring records would not be the only thing broken, when on February 26, 1981, the Minnesota North Stars and Boston Bruins brawled their way to a record 406 penalty minutes in one game. At the beginning of the 1981-82 season, the league would first realign its divisions, as several teams would get shuffled around. Additionally this season, the league honored Montreal goaltenders Rick Wamsley and Dennis Herron with its newest award, the William M. Jennings Trophy, given to the goaltender or goaltenders having played at least 25 games for the team with the fewest goals scored against it.
This distinction used to be what the Vezina Trophy was awarded for, but after the Jennings Trophy was introduced, the Vezina was then awarded to the goaltender that the NHL general managers voted to be the best in the league.
The big highlight this season, though, was when Wayne Gretzky tallied 5 goals against Philadelphia to break the 50 goals in 50 game record by reaching 50 goals in just 39 games. Continuing on from there, Gretzky would close out the regular season breaking 3 more major scoring records with 92 goals, 120 assists, and 212 points. The next couple of seasons would usher in a few changes to the league. First, the Colorado Rockies Club was purchased by shipping tycoon John McMullen and moved to the Meadowlands in East Rutherford, New Jersey, where they became known as the Devils in the 1982-83 season. Then, in 1983-84, the NHL began the practice of adding a 5-minute overtime period to regular season games that ended in a tie. With this new regulation in place, the 1983-84 season was definitely a good one for the Edmonton Oilers, with Jari Kurri, Glenn Anderson, and Wayne Gretzky each breaking the 50-goal mark for the year, and Gretzky himself recording at least 1 point in a record 51 straight games. Even the Oilers' goaltender Grant Fuhr set a new scoring record, with his 14 points being the most ever tallied by a goaltender in a single year. 2 seasons later, the Oilers were once again breaking scoring records when Gretzky topped 2 of his own records with 163 assists and 215 points, followed by Paul Coffey setting a new scoring standard for defensemen when he knocked in 48 goals, en route to the Oilers claiming the regular season championship and the new President's Trophy that came with that accomplishment in the 1985-86 season. But this season would not be all celebrations, as the Philadelphia Flyers would be dealt a tragic blow on November 19, 1985, when their 26-year-old star goaltender Pelle Lindbergh was fatally injured after losing control of his turbocharged Porsche and careening into a concrete wall. Moving on to the 1986-87 season, 2 more league records would be established as the Islanders' captain Dennis Potvin became the first defenseman to reach the 1,000-point milestone. Following that, Hartford's Doug Jarvis became the NHL's new Iron Man, as his streak ended at 964 games played and earned him the Masterton Trophy for his dedication to the game. In the 1987-88 season, another streak would come to an end, when after winning the Hart Trophy for a record 8 straight years, as well as the Art Ross Trophy for a record 7 straight years, Wayne Gretzky was finally dethroned as the Penguins' hot young star Mario Lemieux walked away with both awards. But even though his trophy streak would end this year, Gretzky still made another mark in the NHL record books when he notched his 1,050th career assist on March 1, 1988, breaking Gordie Howe's record for career assists. A few months earlier, hockey fans were also treated to something they had never seen before, when on December 8, 1987, the Flyers' sophomore goaltender Ron Hextall cleared the puck down the length of the ice and into the empty Boston net, becoming the first goaltender to actually score a goal after shooting the puck. Another noteworthy first this season came when Calgary winger Lanny McDonald received the NHL's newest award, the King Clancy Trophy, given to the player best exemplifying leadership qualities both on and off the ice. However, one thing that no one expected was the move that the Edmonton Oilers would make just before the opening of the 1988-89 season. On August 9, 1988, the biggest trade deal in hockey history was made when the Oilers dealt Wayne Gretzky to the Los Angeles Kings, along with Marty McSorley and Mike Krushelinski, in exchange for scoring ace Jimmy Carson, Martin Jelena, numerous first-round draft picks, and $15 million. Only Boston's sale of Babe Ruth to the Yankees in 1920 has carried the same weight as this blockbuster deal.
Oilers fans, though, were not very thrilled. Many protested that the Oilers' owner, Peter Pocklington, had sold his team down the river. Some even pointed at Gretzky's wife, Janet Jones, an aspiring actress and Los Angeles native, saying that she influenced him to leave Edmonton for the glitter of Hollywood. However, it wasn't hard to imagine that Kings fans had the exact opposite reaction to the deal, as the ticket sales to LA's games soared from what they had been previously.
In his first season with the Kings, Gretzky would not disappoint, scoring 54 goals and tallying 114 assists to capture his ninth Hart Trophy in 10 years and lead his team into the 1989 playoffs. Returning to the trail of the Stanley Cup, the 1980s were primarily the tale of the New York Islanders and then the Edmonton Oilers. First, to kick off the 1980 playoffs, the NHL introduced a new four-round, 16-team format in which the top-seeded team was matched with the lowest-seeded team, the second-highest with the second-lowest, and so on and so forth. After the first three rounds of the playoffs under this new format were in the books, the two teams that remained were the Philadelphia Flyers and the New York Islanders in their first-ever finals appearance. The first time was a charm for the Islanders as they won Game 6 5-4 in overtime to win their club's first-ever Stanley Cup title. Behind the offensive power of Mike Bossy, Brian Trottier, and Butch Goring, the defensive skill of Dennis Potvin, and the puck-stopping abilities of Billy Smith, the Islanders repeated as champions in 1981 when they beat the Minnesota North Stars in 5 games. In 1982, the playoff format was altered once again. Now the playoffs would consist of the top 4 teams from each of the 4 divisions playing down to a division champion. Then the champions of the Norris and Smythe divisions would play for the Campbell Conference title, which would now be symbolized by the Clarence Campbell Trophy, while the champions of the Adams and Patrick divisions played for the Wales Conference title, now symbolized by the Prince of Wales Trophy. The two conference champions would then face off for the Stanley Cup title. Once again, the Islanders made it to the finals, this time to face the Campbell Conference champions, the Vancouver Canucks. The series, though, would be over after only 4 games, as the Islanders skated off with their 3rd straight Stanley Cup title. But the Islanders were not done yet. With Billy Smith standing tall in the net, New York was able to shut down the high-powered Edmonton Oilers to win the 1983 Stanley Cup and become only the 2nd team ever to win 4 Stanley Cup titles in a row. However, when New York and Edmonton had a rematch in the 1984 finals, it was the Oilers that prevailed and put an end to the Islanders' dynasty. With an all-star cast that included Wayne Gretzky, Yari Curry, Mark Messier, Kevin Lowe, Paul Coffey, Glenn Anderson, and Grant Fuhr, the Oilers were able to repeat as champions the following year when they bested the Flyers in 5 games for the 1985 title. Heavily favored to win a 3rd straight cup going into the 1986 playoffs, Edmonton would run into one of the worst spots of bad luck when in Game 7 of the Smythe Division Finals against Calgary, the young Oilers defenseman Steve Smith fired the puck from behind his net and through the goal crease, where it banked off of Grant Fuhr's leg and into his own net, giving Calgary a 1-goal lead that they hung on to win the game and eliminate the Oilers from the playoffs. Calgary would continue on past St. Louis to make it to the Stanley Cup Finals, where they faced the Montreal Canadiens. This series would be a duel between the rookie goaltenders Mike Vernon and Patrick Waugh, with 3 of the 5 games played being decided by only 1 goal. And when the final horn sounded at the end of Game 5, it was the Montreal Canadiens that skated to the locker room hoisting the Stanley Cup. Come the 1987 playoffs, though, Edmonton was once again back into their proverbial groove, making it to the finals where they faced Philadelphia and their hot rookie goaltender Ron Hextall. Though the Oilers would win the Cup in 7 games, it was Ron Hextall that claimed the Conn Smythe Trophy as the playoff MVP. Still riding high, Edmonton repeated as champions again in 1988 when they beat the Boston Bruins in 4 games. Well, 4.5, since a power failure at the Boston Garden Arena knocked out the lights with 3.5 minutes left in the second period of Game 4, causing them to suspend the game and replay it from the beginning in Edmonton. However, the following year, Edmonton's hopes of making it 3 straight were dashed in the first round of the playoffs, when the LA Kings, along with their newest addition, Wayne Gretzky, eliminated the Oilers in 7 games. Moving over to the Wales Conference, the opening playoff matchup between the Flyers and Capitals would treat the fans to the first ever playoff goal scored by a goaltender, when on April 11, 1989, Philadelphia goaltender Ron Hextall repeated the feat that he performed against Boston in the regular season a couple years earlier. When the finals rolled around, though, it was a rematch of the teams and goaltenders from the 1986 Stanley Cup Finals, as Mike Vernon and the Flames faced Patrick Waugh and the Canadiens. This time, the Flames prevailed after 6 games for their club's first ever Stanley Cup title. This made the season even more special for their captain, Lanny McDonald, who had also scored his 1,000th career point and 500th career goal that season and now hoisted his first ever Stanley Cup, all in what would be his last year in the NHL, giving him a storybook finish to an amazing career. Another member of this championship team was right winger Sergei Pryakin, who on March 30, 1989, became the first Russian to play in the NHL with permission from the Soviet government. This would just be the beginning, though, as numerous more prominent Russian players were given permission from their government to play in the NHL, giving the league another new source of professional hockey talent as it entered the 1990s. ¶¶